Hey there, welcome back to our channel. If you've been following our recent videos, you'll remember that we've been exploring how to create various light models in WebGPU. However, we neglected an important aspect in those models, shadows. Shadows play a crucial role in adding depth and realism to a scene. In today's video, we'll demonstrate how to simulate shadows in WebGPU. Shadows occur when objects obstruct the path of light rays from a light source, resulting in areas of reduced or no light. This phenomenon, known as occlusion, creates the illusion of depth and enhances the realism of a lit scene. Shadows enable viewers to perceive spatial relationships between objects, enhancing the overall sense of depth. Implementing shadows in real-time graphics is not a straightforward task, primarily because there is no perfect shadow algorithm available. While there are several good shadow approximation techniques, each has its own quirks and limitations that must be taken into consideration. In this video, we'll focus on simulating shadows using the popular shadow mapping technique. This approach is widely used in video games as it yields satisfactory results and is relatively easy to implement. Additionally, it doesn't impose a significant performance cost and can be extended to more advanced algorithms with relative ease. The basic shadow mapping algorithm consists of two passes. First, we render the scene from the perspective of the light source, computing only the depth of each fragment. Then, we render the scene as usual, but with an additional test to determine if the current fragment is in shadow. The shadow test is quite simple. If the current fragment is farther from the light source than the corresponding point in the shadow map, it means that there is an object closer to the light, and thus, the current fragment is in shadow. In this video, we'll focus on a blend-found lighting model and use an orthographic projection to render the shadow map. Alright, let's now dive into the programming aspect. We will start with the project we worked on in our last video. If you already have the project on your local machine, simply open it using Visual Studio Code. If not, don't worry. You can easily download the project from our GitHub repository using the command gitclone followed by the branch name and the repository URL link. This will download the project onto your local machine. Simply open this project using Visual Studio Code. And then use the command npm install to install all npm packages required by this example. The first pass requires us to generate a depth map for the shadow. The shader used during this pass is very simple. It only includes a vertex shader that transforms the vertices to light space and does not require a fragment shader since there is no color needed for the shadow. Create a new vertex shader file called shadow.wgsl in the section 02 folder and insert the following code into it. The main task of this vertex shader is to calculate the positions of vertices and then convert them into light space using a light projection metric. It should be noted that the model metric is a 4x4 matrix array that can be used for generating multiple instances. We now need to implement the blend font model with a shadow test in the usual shader. We need to test whether each computed fragment is behind the shadow map or not. As before, we will separate this shader into two parts, the vertex shader and fragment shader. Create a new vertex shader file named shadowvert.wgsl in the section 02 folder and insert the following code into it. The shader code here is very similar to that used to create multiple instances with lighting effects in the previous video. The difference is that we now pass an extra uniform buffer, light project metrics, to the shader. Furthermore, the VS main function returns an additional shadow position named VShadowPosition. Here, we use the same light projection metric as in the previous depth map shader to transform the positions of vertices in world space to light space, which will be used in the fragment shader. Next, add a new fragment shader file named shadowfrag.wdsl to the section 02 folder and insert the following code into it. This fragment shader code here is very similar to that used for implementing the blend font light model in previous video. However, in this example we add shadow calculation. To do this, we pass the shadow depth texture and its sampler to the shader. It is worth noting that the shadows obtained from shadow mapping can have a lot of aliasing. To reduce aliasing, we use the percentage closer filtering or PCF technique in the fs main function. The concept of PCF is to sample from the shadow map around the current pixel and compare its depth to all the samples. By averaging out the results, we obtain a smoother transition between light and shadow. From the PCF calculation, we obtain an average visibility value, which we use to multiply the resulting diffuse and specular components from the blend font model. Since shadows are rarely completely dark due to light scattering, we leave the ambient component out of the visibility multiplications. In this video, we'll be using a torus shape to demonstrate shadow mapping. To facilitate this, I have included the code in the vertexdata.ts file located in the comment folder. This file is responsible for generating the vertex and index data for the torus. We won't delve into the implementation details of this code in this video, since it has been thoroughly explained in my previous video series and books. Now add a new TypeScript file named shadow.ts and paste the code to the file. This example follows the similar structure to the one used in the previous video. Within the create pipeline function, we will be creating two render pipelines. The first one will be responsible for rendering three-dimensional objects, while the second one will focus on generating shadows. It's important to note that when creating the render pipeline descriptor for the shadow pipeline, we set the with fragment input argument to false. This indicates that the shadow pipeline does not require a fragment state, as our intention is not to render color output for the shadows. Additionally, we need to generate the shadow depth texture using the following code snippet. Typically, the size of the depth texture used for conventional object rendering should match the size of the canvas element. However, we have the flexibility to set the size of the shadow depth texture independently since it is solely used for generating shadows. In this example, we have set the size to 2048x2048, which is the texture resolution. Increasing the texture resolution will yield higher definition shadows, but it is also possible to use lower resolutions such as 1024x1024 or 512x512. We also create vertex buffers for two 3D objects, including a cube for the ground floor and a torus that moves and rotates on the floor. Moreover, we include the shadow depth texture view and sampler to the bind group, which will be passed to the fragment shader. Within the draw function, we first draw shadows and then the 3D objects by setting appropriate vertex buffers, index buffers, and bind group for each render pass. It is worth noting that when creating the render pass descriptor for the shadow pass, we set the with color attachment input argument to false, indicating that we do not need to render any color output for the shadows, and thus do not require a color attachment for the shadow pass. In the run function, to see the shadows clearly, we position the light source above the floor by defining the light position with the following code. This means that the light source is located far away 100 units from the ground floor, making it a directional light source with almost all of its light rays parallel. Therefore, we can use an orthographic projection to create the light projection metric as there is minimal perspective distortion for this type of light source, as demonstrated in the following code snippet. In the frame sub function, we perform various animations, including rotating the light source around the axis, automatically moving and rotating the torus object by updating its rotation and translation. Now, let's proceed to add this example to the navigation menu. Open the site nav.html file from the src.html folder and add the following link shadow. Once we have done, we can proceed to build and compile the code by executing the command npm run prod in the terminal window. Then, clicking on the Go Live to open the default web browser and view the 3D objects with shadow in action. You can see the shadow moves with the torus. Now, let's conclude today's video. In the next installment, we will discuss the procedural terrain generation in WebGPU. Make sure to stay tuned for that upcoming video. Thank you so much for watching today's video. I hope you found it informative and helpful for your WebGPU development journey. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel for more exciting content. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them down below. Until next time, happy coding!